Pruning is an essential part of renewing the vine. When you go through and prune, you're thinking about where's the fruit zone going to be located, where are the leaves going to be, where are the shoots going to emerge from. It's kind of like a method to reshape the vine and reset year after year. When you look at a vine, you kind of look at where cuts have been made in years past. You think to yourself, how did this vine perform last year? Did I get the yields that I needed? Did I get the protection that I needed? Do these shoots look like they grew enough to protect the fruit from heat waves later on? And did they have enough canopy there to effectively ripen the clusters? There's a lot of things that go through your head during pruning. In a sense, it's meditative because you're thinking about so many different things at the same time. But you have this opportunity once a year to go through and shape the vine for the vintage that you're about to experience. But at the same time, you're thinking about what are the repercussions of these cuts in year two, year three, year four. It's not just this one moment you're making a decision. Vine balance is one of the most important concepts to have in your mind when you're out there pruning. You're actively looking at the vine, deciding whether or not the vine performed to your standards. Did it grow enough vegetatively to ripen the clusters that were there last year? Did it provide enough shade to make sure that the clusters didn't burn? Were there enough shoots there to get you the yields that you wanted to see? Generally, in most varieties, each shoot that emerges from a bud will have two clusters. So the more buds you leave, you can essentially multiply that by two and it will get you your maximum number of clusters. You generally want to start pruning once the vines go into full dormancy. If you go in too early and there's still green leaves there, the vines are still photosynthesizing. So you want to make sure that that's completely done and the vines are dormant. Most areas, you're looking at January, February as the main 2 months when you're pruning in the Northern Hemisphere. One of the major considerations with pruning is the later that you prune, the later you're going to see bud break. So in a situation where you can get really heavy spring frosts, or with the variety that likes to break bud early, Cabernet Franc likes to grow early, Sauvignon Blanc likes to grow early, you can actually delay pruning as long as possible with those varieties. Disease pressure during the rainy season is really, really high. It's when a lot of fungal spores are being released during rain events. So one of the golden rules of pruning is you don't want to prune when it's actively raining. The main diseases that vines are susceptible to during the pruning period are Eutypa lata, which is a disease that enters pruning wounds during the rainy season. There's other more virulent types of diseases. One is Botrytis. It moves in a vine even faster than Eutypa. ESCA is another big one, and that's kind of a more of a worldwide problem. Every time you make a wound on a plant, you open it up to susceptibility to one of these types of diseases. Pruning cordon-trained spur prune vines, in a sense, a little bit easier than a cane prune vine because your positions are set in place. You go back to a spur that generally either has one shoot that grew last year or two, and you remove all but two buds from what was there. And it kind of creates this V pattern where you have one shoot emerging from either side of the spur. And that's kind of the regenerative process where you're going back down to two buds, those two buds grow into two shoots, and then you come back when they harden and lignify into canes and do the same thing over and over again. Guillot is the French term for what we call cane pruning in the United States. Cane pruning definitely takes a large amount of skill. Each cut you make is vitally important to the way that that vine is going to continue to progress. A lot of beautiful old head-trained vineyards, you have to be essentially a little bit of an artist. You're trying to move things in particular directions and find space, and you're not confined to anything. You can move a spur in whatever direction you want. I mean, that's why there are works of art in some instances, the really old head-trained vineyards with spurs that are gnarled and going off in every direction. It takes a little bit more of a creative mind to go in and prune head-trained vineyards. After you're done pruning, you end up with a lot of brush, a lot of the used material that was there last year supporting the crop that you have to move out of the way, get rid of. Some folks will manually pick them up, pull them out of the vineyard, chip them, put them in a compost pile, and then return them to the vineyard. But the more common way is to generally drive a tractor through the rows using a flail mower. You chop them up into little pieces. They end up about 3 inches long as opposed to 3 feet long. And they break down over time. Some people still burn them. That's becoming less and less popular. Pruning is by far one of the largest and most time-consuming and most expensive practices that you do in the vineyard on an annual basis. There's a lot of systems though where a lot of things are becoming mechanized in other parts of California. You'll see this in Australia called the high wire system, where you can run box pruner and leave about 4 inches from the cordon, and that's all the pruning that you need to do. So depending on your quality level, your goals that you're after, you can spend a lot of time or you could spend almost no time pruning your vineyard every year.